As we share this morning, I need to take just a moment and reflect on the testimonies that we've heard from Jason and Derek. In addition to being blessed here today, one of my blessings was visiting with them along the way as they prepared and to see their nervousness. And I share that because that's a good thing. Because you see, it's in that nervousness that we realize that we can't do it ourselves, that we have to be dependent upon God and depend upon our faith. And that's not unique to us or to these two or to our time. Jesus' own disciples worried about what are we going to say and what are we going to do. And Jesus looked at them and said, don't worry when they bring you before the rulers and the authorities. In that very moment, the Holy Spirit will give you the words to say. We've seen that shared today. I want you to know that while their testimonies are unique in their experiences, they are not unique in terms of how God works. And every person in here who is a believer has a testimony. The testimony has a primary purpose of bringing glory to God. And when we share personally what God has done in our lives, then God is glorified. I encourage you to use those testimonies and to share those testimonies. Let's bow and pray together. Holy Father, in this place today, as always, we thank you for your presence, for the privilege of being here to direct all that we are to all that you are. As we have done that through the sharing of testimonies and through song and earlier in Bible study, the fellowship that takes place here, all of those things, now we come to that moment in time when we open your word. Today we will share about it, how it is alive and how it is powerful and how it holds us accountable. So bless us as we do that. Use it in all the ways that you desire as we pray together in your Son's name. Amen. Perhaps like some of you, I have a lifelong love of books. And over the years, I've amassed hundreds and hundreds of books, from theological to biographical, from Western novels to military accounts, all different kinds. And they fill bookshelves and closets and boxes and all the other places. And that's been alleviated a little bit by Kindle, but the desire is still there. And perhaps one of my greatest pleasures in life is reading. But I want you to know that if I brought every book that I own in this place and piled them around me, that together they will not come close to touching the importance and the truthfulness of one book that we know as the Bible. It is the supreme word of God that's been given to us as a gift to be read, studied, and cherished. And it ranks above every other book that has ever been written. There's no other book that you can find in any bookstore or anywhere else that is both life-changing and eternity-changing. But God's word is. And while we live in a world that tries to tell us that truth is ever-changing, God's truth that we know as the Bible never changes, and it never adapts to what culture, society says is now the norm and values by which we live. We've designated today as Men's Day. We began with a men's breakfast, and then we've been blessed today in our service as men have sung and have shared their testimonies. You know, above everything else, this is the day to worship God. He says, this is my day. This is the day when everything should focus upon me. And as I share today, the message that I share with you is not just for men, it's for women, it's not just for boys, it's for girls, it's for everybody in here. Because we're going to share the priceless gift that God has placed in our care that we know as the Bible. Now, I thought about it. I could have prepared a sermon that addressed itself just to men. If you've been here very long, you know that typically I don't do that. I don't like to do that. I much prefer to share straight from God's word in the way that the Holy Spirit leads me. But to all the men that are here today, let me go ahead and say this. If men everywhere would read the Bible and follow the spiritual principles that are found in the Bible, our world would be a much better place. And so, men, there you have it. There's more to follow, but I hope you heard that. I want to talk today about faith as we continue to focus on faith. And the Bible is a great example of faith. Because you see, as we read it and as we look at it, we are dependent upon faith to accept it as God's truth. And so we're going to share about that today and look at how the Bible is alive. It's never outdated. We're going to look at how it is a standard for our lives. And listen carefully, we're going to look at how we're accountable for what we do with God's word. You know, here's a fact of the world that we live in. Almost everything around us becomes outdated. If you don't believe me, go buy a cell phone or a computer this afternoon and then check in the morning if there's not one better. I mean, it's just that quick. Anybody remember VHS tapes, film cameras? How about encyclopedias? All gone, outdated. And let me tell you, pretty soon landlines and fax machines are going to join that list. Things change constantly around us. And while some things like good manners and family will always remain important, much of what we experience in our world and what we rely upon becomes obsolete. But friends, there's one thing that's never outdated, it's never obsolete, it's never out of place, and that's God's Word. And this morning we're going to focus on a couple of verses from the book of Hebrews. If you've got your Bibles, go ahead and turn to Hebrews chapter 4. We're going to break this down in a couple of verses that you're familiar with, and you've heard them, I'm sure, several times before, and you'll hear them again. We're going to begin with the first part of verse 12 of Hebrews 4, and here's what it says. For the Word of God is living and powerful. God tells us, He says, I'm going to give you two characteristics, two attributes of my Word. And He says the first one is this, that it is alive. And so we ask ourselves, well, what does it really mean to be alive? Now, the typical answer is that that means it's not dead. But it's a lot more than that. You see, what God tells us is that these words that I give you are never stagnant. They never just sit still. They are not just simply placed on a page and adaptable or applicable to a particular moment. They're timeless, and they are alive. And they're able to communicate and provide for us regardless of the circumstances. Do you know, folks, and I hope that you do, that you can pick up this book any place, any time, in any circumstances, and it will speak to you. Now, find another book like that. There are books all around us that address themselves to specific areas of life and specific topics, but here God has given us a book, and He said, I don't care where you are, where you find yourself, on your best or your worst day, if you will open it and read it, I promise you, you'll find application in your life. Whether it's friendship, marriages, business, relationships, whatever it might be, the Bible speaks to those in spiritual principles that are timeless. And we're also told that this book is powerful. You might remember when we walked through Ephesians that we found ourselves in chapter 6. Chapter 6 of Ephesians deals with spiritual warfare, and it walks through and talks about the armor that we are supposed to take and put on every day to prepare ourselves for spiritual warfare and so that we'll have it when we engage in spiritual warfare. And in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 17, it says this, and take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. Now, let your mind create that image for just a moment. God says, when you think of my word, here's what I want you to think about as you engage in battle. A sword. Now, I don't know about you. You know, I've never been in hand-to-hand combat. But I figure if they laid everything out there and said, you get to pick one thing, I'm picking the sword. And He tells us that's the importance of the Bible. Because it not only wards off the attacks of what come to us, it is offensive in nature in that we can go and use it in our world. And when the world attacks, we find refuge and comfort, protection within it. And when we're armed with this book, we're carrying the strongest weapon possible. And I have to tell you, it's not just a matter of what's found in these pages. You know, I don't know about you, but if I don't have this in my vehicle or on my desk, by my bed or by my side, I feel unarmed. When I walk out there in the world, if I've got this in my hand or in my pocket or close by, I feel better prepared for what the world's fixing to bring to me. And that's not by chance. That's what God says it is. He said it is this incredible, incredible weapon and tool that has been given to us. And He says it's powerful. It's also the standard for our lives. You know, over time, guidebooks come and go. If you look back, what was the definitive guidebook 30 years ago is probably outdated and not looked to anymore. And we get updates and out of dates and all these kind of things. And, you know, on these little wonderful things that we call a cell phone, it's like every 2 seconds they got to update something and run those things to keep it timely. You know, even the question of what's right and wrong in our world that we live in changes almost from day to day. It's amazing when you look back and you see those things that were deemed to be contrary to the values of society 20, 30, 40, 50 years ago that now today are, it's okay. If you want to do that, don't worry about it. And so we don't know year by year what's going to take place around us or how things are going to change or how society or culture is suddenly going to say that this conduct, which formerly was unacceptable, well, it's okay now. Just do your own thing. And the question becomes, in the midst of that, what guides us? Do we just change and yield every single year and every single time a value of society changes and we go, okay, well, I'll accept that now, I'm this? Well, that's not the case at all. Look at the second part of verse 12. As it talks about God's word, it says it's sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the division of soul and spirit, and of joints and marrow, and it's a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. Now, I want to tell you, there's a lot of interesting things about this, because all of us are probably creating this image of God's word going deep. And if you look at the Greek, it's actually what it was. I mean, it was the image of something that would pierce to the innermost parts of the body. But what's really interesting, among other things, with this verse is that it has application both for the believer and the non-believer. You see, for the non-believer, when God's word is open, it exposes their distance and separation from God and their ungodliness, as well as God's desire that they become part of his family. And we've heard those stories countless times of those who have been in a position of solitude, but yet they had scripture and they opened it up and their heart was convicted and they understood what they should do. And that came about because it has the ability to go to the innermost parts. And in the life of the believer, it goes down into the very depths of our hearts. And what we might hold in there and say nobody knows about and all this kind of stuff, God knows. And when you open this book and you begin to walk through it, suddenly you find yourself reading verses and you're going, wait a minute, how did you know that? Because it reaches right into the very bottom of our heart and takes those things that don't need to be there and convicts us of them. For us, when we come under the scrutiny of the Bible, all that is within us is laid bare before God in perfect truth. You see, much of our world today looks at this and they try to escape this conviction by denying its truthfulness. And a good question to ask is, how do we know that what we read in the Bible is the correct standards for our lives? Well, a couple of those verses that really lay that out for us are found in 2 Timothy, the 3rd chapter, verses 16 and 17. It says, all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work. God says every word in this book was written under my inspiration. That's his seal of authenticity. When he says, this is from me. And you know, we live in a world that says, no, wait a minute. Let me ask you this. You're saying that the truthfulness of the Bible is affirmed by the words of the Bible. And some of the world would say, well, that won't work. You got to have some objective outside source that proves it to be correct. Well, let me tell you, if God had wanted to, he could say, here's a Bible, by the way, here's a DVD showing me giving the words to these writers. He could have said, I'm going to write my personal autograph across every copy so there's no doubt about it. You see that over there, the flow of faith? If God had done that, it would not be faith. If God had said, I'm going to make it crystal clear to your eyes, then it'd be a matter of sight and not faith. But the God who says, I'm going to give you this book and nothing pleases me more than faith, cannot turn around and say, you don't accept it in faith. That's what it is, folks. Every time we open it and look at it, it becomes a matter of faith. And every person who hears these words and every person who reads them reaches a moment in time when they either accept them in faith or they reject them in disbelief. Every single person. And that's it. There's no maybes. There's no in-betweens. You either say I accept it or you say I don't accept it. When accepted in faith, they become the standard for our lives. And all through this book, it tells us how we're supposed to respond to what we find in it. Let me share some of those verses with you. In Matthew 4:4, it says, he answered and said, it's written, man shall not live by bread alone, but every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. And way back in Deuteronomy in chapter 6, just this incredible passage that was given as a reminder of the importance of God's word and how important it is to instill it in our children. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength. These words which I command you today shall be in your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your children. You shall talk of them when you sit in your house, when you walk by the way, when you lie down, when you rise up. You shall bind them as a sign on your hand. They shall be as frontlets between your eyes. You shall write them on the doorpost of your house and on your gates. Wow. If you get bored this afternoon, open up that passage and try to find a loophole. Try to find a time when it says you don't need to have God's word around you, before you, within you. In Psalm 119:105, it says, your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. You see, folks, this isn't a book that we read and put up on the shelf and just say that was a good read. We don't just give it 5 stars and say, you know, you ought to check this out sometime. It's the very word of God that's to be light by which we walk and the food that sustains us and what we share with others. And as God tells us about how living and powerful it is and what it can do, he says, I also want you to know this, that I'm going to hold you accountable for a lot of things, including what you do with my word, because there is accountability. Look at verse 13 of Hebrews chapter 4. There is no creature hidden from his sight, but all things are naked and open to the eyes of him to whom we must give account. Now, if you really take a moment and think about that, here's what God says. There's nothing that you do, and there's nothing in your heart that's hidden from me. I know everything. And we often think we can hide it, and we often think we can fool him, but we can't. He says, through this book, everything is laid out there, everything that you are. You know, one of the prominent themes that we talk about in Scripture is stewardship. And in a broader sense, stewardship is when something is placed in the trust or care of someone else. And we see a lot of parables and examples about that when it deals with finances, when it deals with our talents, when it deals with many other things. But you see, God's given to us the most special book that's ever been written. And how short-sighted of us to think that he would not apply the same principle of stewardship to the book that he's placed in our care that he would place on the other things that we have in our life. He has placed it in our care to be cherished and read, studied, and followed. You know, early in my ministry in the smaller churches, when the service was over, I'd go around after the service, everybody would be gone. I'd just kind of walk through the church. I'd go through the sanctuary, and I'd look on the pews, and I'd often find a Bible in there. And so I'd pick up that Bible, and I'd take it back to my office, and I'd keep it there. I shouldn't call it this, but one of the fun things to do was I would hold it there. And maybe 2 months, 3 months, 6 months, somebody would come by and they'd say, have you seen my Bible? And I'd say, yeah, I got it right here. And they'd say, I left it there last Sunday. And I would think to myself, no, you didn't. It's been in here for months. And I thought to myself, you know, if we cared as much about our Bible as we do our car keys and our cell phone, wouldn't that be something? We'd hang on to them. And we would be concerned when we go, where's my Bible? What did I do with it? And not just here, but in our homes and in our workplace and the other places of life. You see, instead of allowing our Bibles to be hidden on the shelf or under a layer of dust, we need to be hiding them in our hearts. But we're going to be accountable. Listen to what Romans 14:12 says. It reminds us of our accountability. So then, each of us shall give account of himself to God. Now, if God says, what'd you do with my word? I want to share a verse with you that tells us what we're supposed to do with his word. It's Psalm 119:11. It says, your word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against you. Now, you see, isn't it odd here? I mean, it's almost paradoxical that on the one hand, we're not supposed to hide the Bible, but to use it because it's living and powerful. But on the other hand, we're supposed to hide the words in our heart. But hidden here does not mean from view. Hidden here means placed deeply within our hearts so they are part of who we are. And so in the circumstances of life, when we're confronted with opportunities to witness, when we face difficulties, when we face trials, we're not running around going, where's that Bible or where's that verse? We've put it in our hearts. And we know, and we can find it. And in faith, we can depend upon it. And let me tell you, folks, in a day when Christians are ridiculed and the Bible is seen as outdated and untrue, we need to be holding this high. We need to be standing firm on everything that it says in it, not giving way to public opinion or because it offends somebody else. I'm not the one offending them. God's word is the one that's laying it out. They just don't have the courage to say, I'm convicted. They want to say, I'm offended. Well, how does what we've shared about the Bible play out in the field of faith? You know, believing this precious book and what's in it is the very essence of faith. If somebody came to me and said, prove it. You know, we can share testimonies which nobody can refute. We can share words which are clearly there. We can debate historically and archaeologically, but ultimately it's always going to come down to faith for every single person. If you don't accept that God wrote it, then it's nothing more than a book of historical accounts and moral laws. But if we open it, read it, listen to it, cherish it, study it, and believe in faith, it becomes a standard for life and a gift to be cherished. You see, every single one of us here today face the same choice. We either live by the ways of the world or we live by the ways of the Word. And let me promise you, if you try to walk with both, you're on a collision course with disaster. This book is not a buffet. It is not a pick and choose. It is God's holy Word, completely truthful. There is no error in it. It comes from his very heart. Today I want to close with what the Bible tells us, and there's so much in here, but I want you to listen carefully. And if you have been here or are here today and you're not sure about your relationship with God, then he has laid it out so clearly, both where we are and where he wants us to be. And he begins by saying that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. There is no exception to that. Every single person has sin in their life, both by nature and by action. But he says that the wages of those sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus our Lord. And God says, separated from me, you are on straight path to eternal separation. But he said, I want you to know something. I demonstrated my love for you and that while you're still a sinner, I gave my son for you. Not waiting a time until a time at which you were worthy, a time at which you had proven yourself or anything else, but because I love you so much that I gave him for you. And he says, if you will confess with your heart the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God's raised him from the dead, you'll be saved. For with the heart one believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. All of us here probably need to invest ourselves more completely in God's word. But my greatest concern right now may be one here who hasn't taken that step of faith to accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior and to forever change your walk here as well as your eternity. And as I pray today, I want you to open your hearts. And God has spoken through his word, not through the mouth of a preacher or other ways, but straight from his word, piercing to the depths of every heart here. And so now we need to respond. So you bow with me as we pray together.